My name is Danny. I'm Chapter Lead Engineering at Wite. Wite is a German software as a service company to help users to build the best website for their target group. We are already close to 1 million users worldwide. Currently, we are at 974,000. Our headquarter is located in Munich, which is here, where we work really, really hard besides enjoying the Oktoberfest together, like you can see here. Since 2017, we also have our own small development center in Ho Chi Minh City, also known as Saigon in Vietnam, which had a beautiful skyline, like you can see here, but also a very, very small traffic issue sometimes, as you can see here. I personally relocated and lived there since last year, and I'm really, really proud of our great team over there, which is the only reason I can stand here today and show you our use case. So I would be awesome to get a short applause for our team. Thank you very much. On the next 85 slides, I want to show you. Yeah, let's get fast. A real-world production drama in three acts with an awesome happy end. Better than most of the movies nowadays. The three main actors of our movie are AWS, Presto, and Alluxio. But before we talk about the technical stuff, I would like to give you a very short introduction what we're doing with our products at Wite to make sure every one of you understand our business and product requirements. We build a software as a service platform to monitor, analyze, and optimize your website to get the best performance out of it. We're doing this by providing a suite of currently three different modules. First, website success. Website success monitors, analyze, and optimize your company's website to achieve a flawless experience for users and search engines. Content success assists you at the stage of the content creation process to build the most relevant content for your target audience. Search success, and this is the module we're talking today about, make your website relevant and visible in search engines to increase your organic traffic for a higher revenue. This is how a typical dashboard in our search success software looks like. For this, we are 100% Google compliant because we are using the Google Search Console as our main data source. Unlike most of our competitors, we don't want to work with scraped data. I want to point this out here just in case some Google engineers or lawyers are in the room. To do this, we had to face some product objectives from the beginning to build a proper MVP back in 2017. First, we need to be able to import multiple gigabytes of JSON data every day. To fulfill our future feature requirements, we have to query always on low-level raw data. No pre-aggregation or data crunching is possible in our case. Because, for example, we build machine learning-based reports like an anomaly detection today, which only works if we have the raw data set available. Our queries are most of the time analytics-like, filtered by X, grouped by day or week, and so on. At all of our product teams, we try to use as much AWS services as possible to reduce the effort of handling low-level infrastructure on our own. This makes us, in the end, faster and more reliable. Then we want to build our software with an architecture to handle instantly 4 times of our current load to run marketing campaigns, for example, without being scared our infrastructure could crash and, on the other hand, prevent us from over-engineering our data backend. And last but not least, we have to check which solutions are able to be handled by our development team, which back in 2017 was quite small in the beginning. This is a very high-level overview here, what we have to do. We get data from the Google HTTP API daily, and we want to store them raw in our backend. This data gets queried by our own web frontend only. For your info, all of our frontends are static React applications communicating over HTTP REST APIs with our backend. The critical part for us, and this is what I'm talking about today, is the data backend. This is how our first solution looks like back in the mid of 2017 when we started. We built a simple import application on AWS EC2, which runs daily to import the data from Google's API into an Elasticsearch cluster managed from AWS. Our front end could call a simple REST API to query the Elasticsearch cluster and forward the data to the front end. The benefits of this architecture was that we get JSON data to import. We just had to transform or simplify them and store them into our Elasticsearch cluster, which, in case you don't know, is using JSON as the default data format. We already had some Elasticsearch knowledge in our teams. The performance was good, and Elasticsearch has great capabilities for analytics like queries. Everything was fine, and we could launch the MVP product to some 1,000 customers after roughly 3 months of development. But there are two big downsides which created us some really big headache after the first months of success. First and most important, an Elasticsearch cluster, at least on AWS, mainly scales on amount of data, not on usage. Means we need more and more instances when we get more data, what happened every day, which cost us a lot of money. Even our usage or amount of customers was keeping stable over time. Second, we had shared and limited DevOps resources and engineers for really big and scaling Elasticsearch setups, because this is getting quite complex. There was no way for us to manage an Elasticsearch cluster on our own instances. This is where episode 2 has started. Here's how we faced these two problems in mid of 2018. We still have our import application and REST API like before, just an evolution from EC2 into Docker container on AWS Elastic Cloud Container Service, because we know everything is better with container. The core update was our switch from Elasticsearch to Presto on AWS EMR, which is Amazon's Hadoop as a service, and AWS S3 as Object Data Store. The main benefit here is that AWS S3 is highly reliable but low cost for data. We're storing our data as compressed packet files, which is a column-based format highly recommended for these kind of data and queries. And we take Presto as our database engine. Presto, built from Facebook, is highly scalable and designed from the ground up for interactive analytics queries. So exactly what we need here. Now our dream comes true. Decoupled write and read performance with AWS S3, there's no bottleneck anymore. Our cost-intensive part, which the Presto cluster, is now mainly based on customer activity, not on the amount of data. And our storage is more reliable than ever before. Just to make sure I can drink. No, you can applaud, it's okay. okay. Here we can see how this setup looks. On the bottom left, we see the REST API, which gets the request from your front end. The API sends an SQL query to the Presto masternode, which is running side by side on the EMR. Hadoop masternode, he makes the query plan, and send a single task to the task nodes on the cluster. Each task node, each task node knows which files he has to read from AWS S3. With the parallelization, we are able to query fast, even with long date range of data. Task nodes are scalable, and AWS S3 even more. When all tasks are done, the final result is created and sent back to the REST API, which forwarded to the front end. With this, we finally solve it. From now on, we are very happy with our fast and reliable architecture. That's it. I really hope you could learn something new from our Presto use case. Thank you for listening. No. Just kidding. Don't worry. The interesting part comes now. end of 2018, around 4 months after release, we got this performance issue here. It was a Monday, 9 a.m. in Germany, where our main market is. This is important later. It happens totally randomly on some queries. When we start investigating, we found out that the affected queries are not bigger or special than other ones. And when we retried them, everything was fast as expected. Here are some original quotes from our customer this time our support team got. As you can imagine, not a really good time for us. So what we did next? We opened a support ticket on Amazon's AWS, explained what happened, and they started to investigate also. Because of the limited time here today for this talk, I cannot go very deep into details, how we escalated with AWS, many teams was involved. This would be enough content for an own talk, what to do if your cloud provider is stressing your business. But in the end, the root cause was that AWS has latency issues on the S3 storage in the Frankfurt region in Germany. Here you can see a graph from the AWS monitoring tool called CloudWatch about the latency of our own S3 requests. Normally, it takes some milliseconds, but at 8 a.m. local time in Germany, it starts increasing step by step up to 25 seconds. We discussed now multiple options to handle this. For example, can we move to another AWS region? The thing here is AWS told us it currently only happens in Germany, but they cannot assure 100% that it doesn't happen tomorrow in another region, like West 1 in Ireland, for example. This is also difficult for us regarding some data protection topics. Move from S3 to another storage solution, like HDFS on our own cluster, for example, or another cloud provider who ever have a proper service. This would be a worst case option for us because it's increased our complexity, is hard to handle, and we need more operational resources. So we said no. Let's looking for some other option. Finally, we got the idea to build a caching layer between Presto and S3. First, S3 is using HTTP. So we researched if we can put, for example, an HTTP proxy like Nginx between our Presto and S3 service. We can also warm up the data and put into the cache when user is loading the application to make it faster. In the end, we want something like a hot and cold solution. If the user is working in the application, the data is coming from a cache and new data or long time unused data is still super reliable on S3. After a lot of try and error with different approaches, we're thinking if we do on our own approach, we have found the messiah, Alluxio. This is what we then built up, episode 3. Between our S3 storage and Presto, we placed Alluxio as caching solution. Now our dream comes really true. Alluxio didn't create any additional hardware costs, as we can see on the next slide. If we need more caching storage, it's also bounded on usage like before, and the implementation effort is very reasonable. It takes us 2 sprints, which means 2 weeks for us, from the idea into testing and finally get it run on production. Handled mainly by 1 DevOps and 1 software engineer from our team in pair programming mode. Here we can see the additional parts of our setups now. The first part are the same requests coming into the API. The API send it to the Presto master node, which creates the single tasks to send it to the task nodes. But now the task nodes didn't request directly S3 anymore. The Presto task node requesting the locally installed Alluxio client, who checks with the Alluxio master who, if someone has cached the file. This could be any task node in the cluster. If this is the case, the Alluxio client sent the cached version back to Presto. If not, the Alluxio worker is requesting the file from S3, cached locally, and send it via the Alluxio client back to the task node, which then execute his part and send the result back to the master node, API, and so on. Directly after release, our symptoms are gone. Our 99% performance on Presto get totally back to normal. Not. Because of Alluxia, our performance got heavily increased. Here you can see our results. Based on the type of report and date range, which increased the amount of files, we reduced our query time by 72% on average. Here are some original quotes after Alluxio was running in production. To visualize this even better, here's the comparison between Presto in orange and Presto plus Alluxio in blue. Okay, this is slide 85, and now I want to end up with some highly confidential recordings from our management meeting after Alluxio was finally deployed in production. Okay, now we are really done. Thanks a lot of Alluxio to having us here today, and thank you for listening.